Assalamu alaikum, my lovelies. How are you all? Hope you've all been well. Ooh, excuse me. I've got an emoji frog in my throat, it looks seems. Okay, sorry about that. Okay, has anyone been thinking about the du'as that we've discussed? I have. Has anybody been thinking a little bit differently in their ruku? I have. When I'm thinking, when I'm in my ruku and I'm talking about Adheem, when I say the word Adheem, I remember Allah, the mighty, the tremendous, and I'm remembering that He's the one that holds up the entire universe and He can bring it all tumbling down, but He doesn't. It's amazing. Honestly, I love it. So if you've been thinking about these things, what you could do is you could get in touch with a family member. Did you know that our Holy Prophet, may Allah send peace and blessings on him and his perfect pure family forever and ever and ever, has taught us that if we reach out to our family during this holy month, then he will send special blessings and mercy on us on the Day of Judgment. How cool is that? I think it's super cool. So, just a phone call to a nani, nana, dadi, bapa, chachi, chacha, mami, mama, fui, fua, or any family member. You can tell them about what you've been learning, and you never know, you might even teach them something. How cool would that be? I think they'd be really impressed. So, you could even talk to your big brothers, or your little brothers, or your big sisters, or your little sisters, and tell them about this. So, let's do that. Okay, so let's have a look at our du'a books. Remember, have your stationery ready. So today we're going to be talking about the du'a that begins Allahumma shahru Ramadan. This is the third du'a in the book. Now, let's have a look at the questions. The first question is how is Allah described in the du'a? And you know that you can fill in the answers from what we're talking about. Okay, so in line one, Allah is described as Rabb. I don't know if you remember, a couple of days ago I said that we'll talk about Rabb again soon. So this is it, we're doing it now. Okay, so Rabb is often translated as Lord, but it means so much more than that. Another word that's used for the translation of the word Rabb is the nourisher. Now the nourisher means somebody who gives food and water. But again, it means so much more than that. It's just amazing. So our Rabb is our Allah. It explains how he's so nurturing. Now what that means is that he gives us things and he wants to teach us things. It's like he takes us by the hand and guides us as to what is right for us and he gently shows us the best way. So if we're doing something wrong, he's going to gently show us the right way. He's not going to tell us off straight away, but he's going to direct us to what is right. He refines us to make us the best that we can be. So Rabb is just amazing. The name Rabb, it's absolutely amazing. And you know Allah, he's only the Rabb for us. He's not a Rabb for the animals because they don't know the difference between right and wrong. He's teaching us, he's guiding us the right way. And on the other side, there's the shaitan. And they're suggesting that we go the wrong way. But we're going to be smart, aren't we? We're going to know that we want to follow Allah, follow what's good, follow our Rabb, not follow the shaitan. I'm not going to do that, are we? No. Okay, so in line number 7 and 8, we are asking Allah to forgive us. Allah is the Ghafoor. He's the one that forgives us continuously. Whenever we ask for forgiveness, he forgives us. He doesn't note down the things that we do wrong straight away. He gives us time. He gives us time to say sorry and ask for forgiveness. I think that is just amazing. Now, what does it mean when we ask for forgiveness or we say we're sorry? Saying sorry and asking for forgiveness means that we're promising that we're not going to do it again. So we can't say, oh Allah, I'm sorry, oh Allah, please forgive me, and then do it again. Doesn't work, does it? We have to promise that we're not going to do it again. We can ask Allah to help us not to do it again, but we have to be really careful not to do it again. It's really, really important, okay? Because otherwise it's not a real promise. Okay, in line 9, we call Allah using the names Jalal wal Ikram. Now this means the one who possesses majesty and honor. So let's explain this a little bit more. Allah is so, so, so amazingly super powerful. How can I think of an example like us? It's a bit like if we are walking outside and we're wearing our big boots and we see an ant on the ground. Now, it's really, really easy for us to stamp on that ant, isn't it? And squish it and kill it. But do we do that? We don't do that, do we? Because it's not the right thing to do. It's not the honourable thing to do. So here, the Jalal wal Ikram, the one who has all this majesty and honour, this is where it all comes from. He is the source of this honour. The next question is asking us the 3 main requests in this dua. Now, the first request, or the first dua, is us asking Allah to send blessings on the Holy Prophet and his perfect, amazing family. That is a dua in itself. We are asking Allah to do that. And by the way, it's the best dua to start a dua with. We've learned that from understanding and looking at the duas that were written by our amazing Ahlul Bayt. Smart, huh? So, we've done that. The next dua is we ask Allah for the opportunity to go for Hajj. We'll talk about that in a second. And finally, we ask Allah to forgive our sins. Now, let's think about Hajj for a minute. What is Hajj? Hajj is, yes, it's that thing that we need to do once in our lifetimes. And it's not, we weren't all us, kids and grown-ups in time of COVID, won't be able to go for Hajj. But let's think about what happens on Hajj and how we can use these ideas to actually have a Hajj inside our hearts. What are you talking about, Memoji Masi? Well, basically, the idea of going for Hajj, it's like a system reset. For computers, that means start again. And for everybody, it means start again. I'm a computer person. That's why I know. Okay, so what's a system reset? It means when we start again, when we have all of our sins forgiven as people. And how do we do this? And we kind of reset where we're supposed to be. Okay, so when we go around the Kaaba 7 times, which is one of the things that we do when we go for Hajj, we are reminding ourselves that Allah is at the center of our lives. We are constantly, so we're going around the Kaaba. If we imagine that the Kaaba is basically where we would have Allah as the center, and we go around the Kaaba 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times. So our whole life, we are moving around the Kaaba. We are moving around having Allah in the center. And it means that we are all like, you know how the planets all orbit around the sun? That's kind of like what going around the Kaaba reminds me of doing, all orbiting around the Kaaba. all going around Allah, and we're doing it because that's what he's told us to do, just like that's what he's told the planets to do, and where all the Muslims are doing it. So that's just one example of how we are centering ourselves back to having Allah as the focus of our lives. And the last question in the book, let me have a look at my book, is what two names of Allah are used in the dua? Ah, we've already talked about that, haven't we? And you know, I'm going to say it again. I'm a video. You can stop, you can pause me. You can watch me again, because I'm not real. I'm a video. Okay guys, I will see you in our next session. Take care. Good afternoon.